That music was first heard in a field in the summer of 1940 in Nancy in France. The clarinetist Henri Acoca stood grumbling about the music's difficulty. The composer, Olivier Messiaen, stood next to him. The music stand was a cellist called Étienne Pasquier. That was his role in the occasion, standing in the middle of a field in the rain, playing a piece of music that was part of nothing bigger, just a simple sketch composed because the clarinetist asked for it. And musically, that's the beginning of the story that we're going to tell you this evening, as we welcome you to the end of time. My name is Tom Redmond, and it is a great pleasure to welcome you here this evening to the Stoller Hall for an extraordinary evening in which we're going to hear perhaps one of the most extraordinary pieces of music ever composed, performed by an ensemble making their debut here this evening as the Ensemble in Residence. Their inaugural performance is the Ensemble in Residence. We just heard Fraser Langton playing the clarinet, and we're now going to welcome to the stage the rest of his colleagues, violinist Rakhi, Singh, pianist Simon Parkin, cellist Guy Johnston. Please welcome to the stage Manchester Collective. Athletic, Fraser, where you sort of leapt up onto the stage in such a fashion. You did work on that, yes, yeah. The tape was there especially. So, Manchester Collective this evening are going to perform you Olivier Messiaen's Quartet for the End of Time, a work which is surrounded by so many stories, so many myths, so many facts, that actually to hear the piece, you need to know a little of it beforehand. And we thought over the next half hour or so we would unpick it, unpack it, and hopefully shine some light on some of the things that make this piece mean even more than it already does. So the piece that we just heard, as I said, stood alone. Three soldiers captured by the Germans marched from Verdun to Nancy, and along the way, this charismatic clarinet player talked to the composer Messiaen and said, write me something, write me a piece of music. And so Messiaen duly obliged. And that's what he came up with, that piece, The Canyon of the Birds. But it was for no purpose other than that. There were only three musicians, and eventually they were transferred to Stalag 8A, a prisoner of war camp in Görlitz, Silesia, now in Poland. And there, a fourth musician came along. His name was Jean Laboulaire. He's a violinist, had been a student, left his studies in Paris to join the army. He too was captured, interned in the camp with these three other great, great musicians. Messiaen was treated like some sort of royalty when he arrived at the camp. He was well known as a composer. He was celebrated in France for his work. Born in 1908, and already, from a very young age, people knew that this was going to be a composer like no one else. Clearly, he was going to set his own path. Before the war, he was already teaching, performing, composing in France. And so when he arrived at Stalag 8A, he was seen almost as a celebrity. I mean, not in a celebrated bow down to the celebrity, but he was known as a composer, and that was something. That meant something. And so he was given certain privileges. He was given space to compose, which sounds quite grand, doesn't it? But this wasn't a sort of a lakeside shack like Mahler would have had. No, instead he had a small private area in the latrine. He was also given manuscript paper and pencils. And for his three new friends in the camp, he wrote a piece of music, again, for no other purpose than their entertainment. And we thought we might hear a little of it now. This became the fourth movement of the Quartet for the End of Time. It's a little interlude, which was played, as I say, in a lavatory.
Thank you.
I've seen some strange things in gents' toilets before, but you can imagine the surprise of any other prisoner arriving to find that being played by three friends in the sort of in the latrine area. Still, Messiaen had no intention of writing anything. This is a really unusual combination of instruments. There was only one other piece, as I am aware, that was written for this quartet. That was written by Hindemith. But Messiaen didn't know that. He just happened to have with him three friends, who by then, some had instruments. Akoka, the clarinetist, had traveled with his clarinet. He took it with him everywhere. The cellist, Pasquier, he managed to borrow a cello. He was given one by the guards, and similarly, a violin was found for La Boulaire. Messiaen had no piano at this time. That would come later on. But in the meantime, he started to think about the idea that maybe he could compose something for this group of players. It's that work we're going to hear in its entirety in the second half. Messiaen, as I said, wrote in many, well, not unorthodox, but they were unorthodox. Would you use that word to describe his writing?
Well, unconventional.
Groundbreaking and unique. Simon is a very wise man. He is a knower of all things. So I'll turn to him every now and then for factual information. You can already hear huge contrast in the way that he's writing. The solo clarinet piece, the canyon of the birds, followed by that interlude. Very different, very rhythmic music that we heard there. But birds are significant to Messiaen in everything he did. He was one of the great ornithologists and musicians, and he spent a great part of his life writing down birdsong, turning it to music. In those early days in Verdun, when he was still serving, before his capture, he used to sign up for the early watch so he could be there for the dawn chorus. So when he came to write this piece, Quartet, the first movement begins then, at sort of 4 a.m., which is the first songs. And this is, I think, the first time he used them in music. And we hear this beautiful, beautiful duet between a blackbird and a nightingale. So we're going to go to the very beginning of the piece now. We're going to hear something from the first movement, sort of this dawn chorus, if you like, as he could create for the instruments that he had available for him. So normally when you hear that, actually the thing that really stands out is that conversation, the song between the two birds, the blackbird and the nightingale. But in the middle of it all, the cello is making the most extraordinary sound. And the colour that the cello produces is so key to hearing Messiaen's music. Messiaen had a condition called synesthesia, where sounds turn to colours in his mind. Now, it wasn't as extreme as some people have with synesthesia, where he didn't sort of react to sounds and see colours immediately, but he said he described it as an intellectual synesthesia, where colours came through sound. And those colours come in some of the harmonics that we hear in the cello. Can we just hear what you play at the very opening, which is really quite unusual at the beginning of the first movement? And it's just there in the background, underneath the birds. Thank you very much. But those colours are always present, for you're not always aware of them, but it's sort of what blooms, this incredible palette of sound that you get. Now, one of the colours that he saw clearly was the colour red with a key of E major. And I wanted to try and explain a little more clearly what colours and harmonics and sounds mean in Messiaen's music. So first of all, I wonder, Simon, if you could play us a chord of E major, and perhaps magically, the room would become a glorious sunrise red. With just do as a chord, first of all, please, yeah. You know, you do have an incredible power, Simon, I've always known. So there's our red, and that's a chord of E major. And within E major, we have, in that chord, four notes, E, G sharp, B, and E. But for every note that you hear on a piano, can I have some normal lights again, please? Wow. Nearly. I'm no Jedi. Within those notes, there are harmonics. Every note that you hear is part of something called the harmonic series. Every note can generate more overtones, more ghostly colours of sound. And you can hear them perhaps better if you can see them first. So actually, I wonder, can you help me? It's very straightforward, don't worry. I want to try and explain what the harmonic series is using a children's slinky. So if you could just take the end of this for me and just come over here. It's all right. All right, and then squat down. And I want you to just put that on the floor. All right, now imagine, Simon, if you could play me a very low E, please. All right, so there's our fundamental, okay? And so if I just make the slinky move like this, you can see simple slinky moving on the floor. Now, if I double the speed of that vibration, the slinky splits in two, and we arrive at the second harmonic, an octave high. If I double the vibration again, the slinky goes into three. We have three nodal points, points of no acoustical resonance, and the harmonic series increases again. The next one is a fifth higher. Double it again, and again, and again, and you see the harmonics keep appearing as the slinky gets more and more manic on the floor. So that's what's happening the whole time you're hearing this music, is the harmonics are released in the top. The slinky's getting faster. The harmonic is split into many, many, many parts. And they start appearing in the sort of, in the air. But you have to listen very carefully for them. So we're going to do another experiment now without the slinky. But Simon, can you now strum us the piano? And we're going to release the harmonics in an E major chord. So that bright red almost starts to separate. And you see all the colours that can come from that glorious sunrise red. So let's go red again. Just listen to how those sounds separate. You're sort of aware of sort of different things just coming out of there, aren't you? You sort of the initial burst of colour and it starts to spread. Those tiny, tiny details, which on first glance aren't there. And certainly when they first performed it in Stalag 8A and Messiaen was playing on a battered old upright piano, it wouldn't have been as obvious as they would in a scientifically designed room like this. But those harmonics are always present in everything that Messiaen wrote. And he was very conscious of bringing those out, of bringing those colours. Such was his incredible ability to hear and interpret colours in sound in that way. So the harmonics are part of the colouring of the music. And talk about time as well, but let's hear a little more. Can we play from the beginning of the second movement, please? Thank you. So we go from extreme violence to that still serenity. And that spreading of time is so important, as you would imagine, with a piece called The Quartet for the End of Time. But the title isn't in relation to his incarceration. You know, this wasn't a piece in protest of the fact that he was in prison. Far from it. Messiaen was a deeply, deeply religious man, a devout Catholic. And time, in the sense of this piece, time in the way he spreads it in that way, is an escape from the confines of what we consider to be time. And he does this in a number of ways. Simon's going to talk about the way he extends rhythm, but actually his idea of pulse in this piece is truly, truly remarkable. Most of us, most of the time, will function at about 80 beats per minute. If we're very healthy, if we're very fit, I'm not, a resting pulse would be about 55 to 60. If we had no caffeine, no stimulants, nothing. If we were sat down, very calm, resting pulse, ideally, should be around there. Most of the time, we exist at about 80. We speak at about 80 beats a minute, and that's about 3 words per second. That's the speed I'm speaking now. And that's quite a comfortable way to be. If I asked you to count to 60 at a normal speed, you can normally count to 60 in about 40 seconds, okay? It's difficult to stretch that to a minute because a second is quite slow, okay? Now, what Messiaen does is ask the musicians to play at 20 beats per minute, which goes from about 3 words a second to 1 word every 3 seconds. Which, even for allowing for sort of theatrical Obama-like pauses, is a really unnaturally slow speed to exist at. I mean, really, really slow. And I wonder, actually, musicians, you know, this, it's hard, isn't it, to slow yourself down to this speed. It's so, so far removed from our normal way of life. I mean, if you were in a nightclub, you would take a stimulant to dance faster to about 150. This would require, Rakhi, you said something like ketamine in order to slow us down. So we're not doing that. We're not using horse tranquilizers for the performance. But how do you slow yourself to that way of playing?
Well, personally, I can't speak for these guys, but I would practice being really slow. So, I mean, I would set myself the target, I'm going to do slow bows for 1 hour, and maybe I'd manage half an hour or something, but you have to get into some sort of meditation, because it's a physical feeling just as much as an emotional or breathing.
I mean, the two of you guys, well, you have these two such beautiful solo movements, but they're both at this unbelievably slow pulse. What do you do? How do you find your 20 beats per minute?
Well, initially we played it through in rehearsal, and Simon and I, the fifth movement, and when we went back, we actually took out the repeating chords and patterns and just basically sped the whole thing up so we could still feel that we were connecting with the movement, the harmonies, at a quicker rate, so that it was easier for us to understand the lines. But, and I guess when it's at such a slow tempo, you have to keep the line somehow at the same time as being really still. So that's, I think, one of the biggest challenges with that particular movement.
The cheating way is to count double speed and hope no one notices.
But I mean, Messiaen was so, so specific about the speed. And musicians are notorious. If you have a piece of music that says a speed, you'll always play it faster, okay? It's just that's what musicians do. Now, he knew that musicians throughout the age would always speed it up. So he sets the metronome marking sort of 15% slower to make sure that even with that sort of musician's excess, it'll be at the speed that he wanted. But can you just play us your part of the eighth movement, just so we can hear what one beat of the bar says. Well, actually, I may be all 4 beats. So that's 1. But after a while, you do start to slow to that speed. And that's why this music affects us the way that it does. because it's so hypnotic, so mechanical in its precision that the beauty sort of bursts from us when we hear it. Now, these two solo movements we're not going to hear in the first half. We'll only hear them in the complete performance, because I think humans can only cope with it once in an evening, both to play and to hear. But Fraser, also, your timeless movement, the bird movement you played from up there earlier on, now, this really is an exploration of time. And he does, you know, there's no beginning or end to the sound, is there? And he asks you to do something really quite exquisite in the clarinet part. Can you just show us a little of your timeless entry? Round of applause, actually, if you don't mind. But we were just talking in the dressing room before, you know, how did Messiaen, whilst marching from Verdun to Nancy, how did he know that a clarinet could do that?
It can't.
It can't. It's a myth. Did you just sing that?
The thing is with that note, it's like you get three chances to do that in this solo movement. And it's a completely different thing doing it in isolation than doing it in the context of this piece as a whole, which I've been reminded of in the rehearsals this week. Because there's so much to do either side of this that you sometimes forget that there's this sort of movement that stops time for, well, you should, I mean, I'm not going to say how long it is because that's irrelevant in the context of how we're speaking about it, but I've sort of lost my train of thought there.
It's timeless.
It's having the right effect on me. The same problem exists in this movement with how slow it is. It's not as slow, but I suppose I can get away with it a bit more because I'm not bound to anything. It's literally just the clarinet. So it can be freer, and I suppose that's more what it's about, this movement, is that time does stop and time exists without our reality that we are in. So,
but he makes you go further than is naturally comfortable, doesn't he? Because, you know, you're not restricted by another part, but you are restricted by lung capacity. But in a way, you have to go beyond that, don't you? Because the music almost instructs you to do that.
It's a real test of stamina and just something that sounds so simple, like starting from nothing. Like, just to say it like that is very simple, but it means so much within the context of the piece. And it's a real moment for a risk to be taken, I think, to create that sort of vacuum of time. Does that make sense?
The whole time the musicians were rehearsing this in the camp, they were all questioning Messiaen, how do you expect us to play this? Because nothing like this had been heard before. Nothing like this has really been heard since. But the technical demands that he puts on the players are really off the scale. Technical levels at this time weren't what they are today because musicians weren't required to have this sort of technique. This was groundbreaking. So they were learning to do things on the spot, on the bog, I suppose, in the latrines. But the whole time, Messiaen would reassure them, yes, you can do it. Yes, you can. It's going to be all right. Yes, you can. Yes, you can. But it's not just the way he spreads time. And this is why I wanted to talk to you about rhythm, Simon. And maybe we should hear something of the sixth movement and then talk about how he breaks away from what we might normally write down as a rhythm. Thank you. clap that back? No. It could have been a good dictation exercise. The thing with Messiaen's rhythm is he didn't like the confines of time. He didn't like the confines of sort of binary rhythm. Now, in the same way that we operate at 80 beats per minute, we also generally move in twos and fours. If we're walking, it's in a two. If we dance, it's in a four. That's our sort of our strict regimen. Most of the things we do operate in twos and fours. Messiaen didn't like that, though, because he felt that it wasn't natural. It sort of is, because it's part of our symmetry as humans. But he said natural rhythms, things like waves, things like the wind in the trees, didn't happen in such a regimented pattern. And so he started to mess around with rhythm, didn't he, Simon? And goes further and beyond and changes.
That's what makes it difficult to learn, because you have to unlearn a lot of things. We're used to feeling a beat. If you try to do this with a beat. Everything goes against the beat and just works, and you have to start having variable beats. And because the beat relates to a pulse, you tend not to have all that variable pulse, so you have to count. Some beats have got like an extra dot in, so if you have a normal scale in quavers, and you put dots on a few of them, so that's one thing that he does. He adds a semiquaver to a crotchet, or he adds a semiquaver to a quaver just in the middle of the bar. Which means in this movement he can't do time signatures anymore. If he did, there would be things like 17, 16, and 21, 8, and things like that, but you can't really get your head around. So you have to stop thinking of making a beat and start having a kind of variable pulse. Another thing that he likes to do is what he calls non-retrogradable rhythms, which is a fancy way of saying palindrome, which is a fancy way of saying the same thing forwards as backwards. So just an example of that, in this movement, you go so it's always five long, five short, five long.
That's why I asked Simon to explain this.
But all the things you learn in school, you have to kind of throw out of the window to play this piece.
They didn't teach us.
No.
No, it's not on the syllabus at Chet's. But it's true, I mean, everything we learn is always counting in twos, threes and fours, you know, all versions thereof. So once you get to this, you are completely and utterly unlearning what you've always known. So these three musicians in Stalag 8A, not only in the most horrific circumstances, are also having to relearn everything they thought they knew about music to perform this piece, with Messiaen saying, of course you can do it, it'll be fine. Reassuring words.
Well, when you've got so much time to kill, you may as well.
It's true. But they did have, actually, an extraordinary amount of time, more so than a modern chamber ensemble would have. You know, Manchester Collective had just this last week, but those four prisoners would meet every day for an hour at 6 o'clock at the end of their duties, extra time on Sundays when the rest of them were on social duties. And they did this for some weeks until finally the performance took place, January 1941, inside one of the communal areas. Now, this is one of the stories that isn't necessarily factually correct. You know, Messiaen always said there were thousands of people and everybody was listening with rapt attention. Now, the last bit was, but there weren't thousands of people. There were only about 300 or 400. And Pasquier, the cellist, in later life said, why do you always tell people there were so many? He said, because it's a better story. Messiaen always used to say that Pasquier played the piece with just three strings on his cello as well. And again, that's not true. There were four. And again, it wouldn't be possible, would it? I mean, you're well known for your three-string cello antics guy, aren't you?
The fifth movement is only on two strings.
Okay.
Yeah. But no.
You're gonna lay that down. Do you want to give me two of your strings in the interval and prove that you can do it? No. But it was a four-string cello that Pasquier used in the performance. So Messiaen quite liked the air of mystery that surrounded it. But there's no denying the fact that when they did perform it to the 300 or 400 inmates in the prison, it was one of the most extraordinary performances anybody has ever heard. And the descriptions of it are sort of life-changing before you've heard the music. 400 prisoners of war in freezing conditions. There's no denying that. Snowing. Sort of a falling down shed, falling down piano, and three musicians playing on the instruments that they could find, a piece of music that would define a century, if you like. And the truly extraordinary thing is those musicians never saw each other really again. 2 months later, Messiaen and Pasquier were released. The same guard that allowed them time to compose faked a signature on a document to say that they were actually musicians and they should go back. They should be released from the prison. They weren't. They were medical auxiliaries. They shouldn't have been allowed to go. But he allowed them that chance to escape. Violinist Labolier, he went a little bit later on. Akoka, who was actually a Jewish Algerian, couldn't. He wouldn't be allowed to go. And he eventually escaped. He tried 4 times to escape from the camp. And on his fourth attempt, he was successful. He jumped from a moving train, still with his clarinet under his arm. And he eventually got his way back to Marseille, where his job was in the first place. He returned to his orchestra there, and he couldn't leave. It wasn't safe for him to go away from Marseille, an escaped prisoner living in France, desperately trying not to be recognized as he played his clarinet. The violinist Laboulaye went back to France. He never played the violin. He turned to acting, because his career as a violinist was on the edge of starting, but couldn't continue. He took out too long in his war service, and he said he didn't want to spend the rest of his life catching up. Messiaen obviously went down in history, and Pasquier was one of the finest cellists in France, a very, very well-known chamber musician. Now, Pasquier and Messiaen saw each other. The others didn't. Akoka was always in Marseille. He said, I meant to. But then Akoka died very young, never saw the others. Le Boulet said, those friendships you form in those circumstances, they're strong, they're powerful. I always meant to write, but we went our separate ways. And that's really quite remarkable, isn't it? To think the conditions, the situation, the peace that they created, and it disappeared like time itself, the people who played it. Now, Messiaen being such a religious man, people have always asked, why did he write this piece in 8 movements when 7 is such an important number? You know, the creation is 6 days, the Sabbath on the 7th. Well, the 8th was this journey into somewhere else. You know, a journey into the most beautiful, timeless light. And it's that you hear at the end of this piece. It's that you'll hear after the interval. Thank you very much, and enjoy your trip to the end of time.